miss the real worship. Of course, I was ministering in some other churches. Last 2 months, I went to Florida, and I've been preaching in 2 different churches. Praise God. My subject for today is the authority of a believer. We all claim to be a Christian. We all claim to be a believer in Jesus Christ. And we should know what is our authority. What is your authority God has given according to His scripture? We are in a hostile world, the world which is not favorable to us. We have a common enemy, the enemy of our Lord. The enemy who tried to tempt Adam and Eve, drag them to sin. And the whole humanity suffered the consequence. We have same enemy tried to tempt Jesus of Nazareth with 3 different temptations. And that we have to face the same enemy today until the millennial reign take place. So, without realizing our authority, without recognizing the authority of the word of God given to a believer, our life will be a failure. So let us know what's our authority. Today, the theme of my main subject is based on the book of Ephesians, chapter 1, 2, and 3. The first scripture I am going to read, Ephesians chapter 1, 16 till 18. Book of Ephesians chapter 1, verses 16 till 18. Here Apostle Paul writes to the church of Ephesus and says, I have not stopped giving thanks for you. That means Paul says, I have been giving thanks every time continuously for you. Remembering you in my prayers. That means I have been praying you without ceasing, without any break. He says, I keep asking that God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the glorious Father, may give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation so that you may know him better. I am asking the Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, to give you the wisdom and revelation that you may know him better. And verse 18 says, I pray also that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened. That seems to be strange. How many of you got the eyes for your heart? Apostle Paul says, I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened. That means your spiritual eye may be enlightened, open, that you could see what you have to see, in order that you may know the hope to which he has called you, the riches of his glorious inheritance of saints. I'm going to stop it here, and I'm going to another scripture to prove that we have the eyes of our heart. I want you to look on the 2 Kings chapter 6, verse 16. Go to the Old Testament, 2 Kings chapter 6, verse 16. Here, the verse says, and he answered, fear not, for they that be with us are more than they that be with them. I know you don't understand, you don't follow anything out of context I'm speaking. Let me explain the circumstances, the context of this one. During the Old Testament time, there were war between Israel and the Syrians every time. Philistines and all the neighboring countries. But it was continuous war between the Syrians and Israelites. And the Syrian kings made plans and said, let's go and hide in such a place that we could defeat the Israelites when they come. But he made his plans and programs, the man of God, King Elisha, hallelujah. He's being the prophet of God. He knew what is going to happen. He told the king of Israel, don't go that way. They are hiding there. Go another way and attack them. Not only once, twice, many times it happened. Then king of Syria becomes so disturbed and called his servants and asked, who among us is working for the king of Israel? And they said, none of us, O king, but there is a prophet in Israel, prophet Elisha. What you talk in your bedchamber, it is known to him. And he goes and communicates to the king of Israel. So that's the reason we have been defeated. Now, then king of Syria asked, spy out and find where this prophet Elisha is hiding. And they said, he's in Dothan mountain. So what happened? The king of Syria got a big army in order to catch one person. Horses and chariots and sent at midnight and around the mount where Elisha was. Early in the morning, the servant of the king Elisha woke up and seen the big army surrounded. And he said, oh, my master, alas, we are going to die. The enemy is going to devour us and kill us. Then prophet Elisha said, verse 16, fear not, for they that be with us are more than they that be with them. Then prophet Elisha prayed. He didn't pray, Lord, save us, Lord, protect us, Lord, kill them, destroy them. But he prayed, Lord, I pray that you open the eyes of my servant, hallelujah, that he might see. Was he blind? No. Eyes of your heart, your understanding. The Bible says, not by sight, but by faith. We need to have that faith. We don't walk by sight, but by faith. That's what Apostle Paul prayed. I pray also that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened in order that you may know the hope of to which he has called you, the riches of his glorious inheritance of the saints. Paul did not make this prayer for the churches at Ephesus alone. See, we started with Thessalonians chapter 1, and the verses says, I pray for you. But he did not pray for those churches alone. He prayed universally. Even he prayed for you and me in the Mountaintop Church, because he prayed in the Spirit. You may be wondering, how could he pray for us? Okay, I'm going again, switch back to another scripture. I want you to turn to Gospel of John, chapter 17. Verse 20. If you look at the context there, the verse 20 says, neither pray I for these alone, but for them also which shall believe on me through their word. Still it's going out of context. Let me explain. The 17th chapter of John, that's a prayer of Jesus. Whole chapter is Jesus praying for his disciples. Jesus knew his time is short. He's going to be taken away from the world. He's going to be killed by the adversaries. So he started to pray. He was thinking about his followers, the disciples and those who believed in Jesus. And he prayed, verse 9, he says, I pray for them. I pray not for the world, but for them which thou hast given me. They are thine. Verse 15, I pray not that thou shouldest take them out of the world. I'm not praying that you should take them away from the world. But they are in the world. They are not of the world. They are in the world. Protect them, Lord. Preserve them. Then verse 20, verse 16, they are not of the world, even as I am not of the world. Verse 20, he says, he prays, neither I pray for these alone. I am not only praying for my disciples alone. Let's see what does the scripture says. See, neither pray I for these alone, but for them also. To whom? Which shall believe on me through their word. Hello? How did we believe? Because the disciples, the apostles went and preached the gospel, and their followers preached till it is continuing until today. Hallelujah. That means Jesus prayed for every member in this church. Hallelujah. Can you say amen? Amen. Hallelujah. We have been prayed by Jesus. Oh, glory. What a great privilege. Amen. So we are privileged. The book of Ephesians teaches that the authority belongs to a believer. It is not for everyone, for a believer. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12. Book of Ephesians, chapter 6, verse 12. The scripture says, for we wrestle not against the flesh and blood, but we wrestle against the principalities, but we wrestle against the powers, but we wrestle against the rulers of the darkness of this world, and we wrestle against the spiritual wickedness in the high places. Four kinds of enemies we have. For we are not wrestling, we are not fighting with our brothers and sisters, our own human being, not with the flesh and blood, but we wrestle against the principalities, against the powers, and against the rulers of the darkness of this world, and but against the spiritual wickedness in the high places. Hallelujah. We have a common enemy, a universal enemy, that's the devil. He says, let me explain one of that, spiritual wickedness in the high places. In the high places. I want you to turn to the book of Daniel, chapter 10, verses 12 to 13. I'm going to give one illustration. This is such a big subject, I can preach for 3 hours, 6 hours, continuously. Until you sleep, I can preach. But I'm just jumping. So, Daniel chapter 10, verses 12 to 13. He said unto me, do not be afraid, Daniel, for from the first day that you set your heart on understanding this and on, humbling yourselves before God, before your God, your ways were heard. And I have come in response to your ways. But the prince of the kingdom of Persia was withstanding me for 21 days. Then behold, Michael, one of the chief princes, came to help me, for I had been left there with the king of Persia. Let me explain it to you again. Prophet Daniel, most favorable man, that's what God says, Daniel. He was in Babylon. He never compromised with the king or his associates. He never even ate the food which is prepared for him. He never agreed to worship the king or follow the customs of the country. That's what Jesus said. In the world, not of the world. We are in the world, not of the world. We don't do what the world does. But Daniel was fasting and praying. How many days he prayed? 21 days. He was praying for a particular subject. What happened? He was going on fasting and praying. But here comes Gabriel and says, I am Gabriel. I come with the answer. The very first day you prayed, God has sent the answer to you. Hallelujah. I am the secretary of communication. He was carrying the message. Why should I say secretary of communication? Gabriel's duty was to take the message. You have so many illustrations. Gabriel went to Mary and said, you shall be with a child. Jesus will be born. With God, nothing shall be impossible. prior to that, Gabriel went to Elizabeth and Zechariah and said, John will be born. Nothing shall be impossible unto God. Prior to that, he went to Lot and spoken about the destruction of Sodom and Gomorrah. Prior to that, he went to Abraham and Sarah. You will be blessed with a son. Your name shall be called Abraham instead of Abraham. You will be called the father of many nations. Hallelujah. That's every time he said, I am Gabriel, who stands in the presence of the Lord. Here says, I am Gabriel. While I was bringing the message, the spiritual wickedness in the high places, God is up above. The angel was bringing the message. King of Mede of Persia, he blocked him, did not allow Gabriel to come. Then God has to send a warring angel. You know who is that warring angel? You all know Michael, with a sword. And said, God sent Michael. He fought with the king of Persia and defeated him. And he's standing there. I'm here with the good news. Hello? When we pray, the very moment we get the answer, but it's not reaching to each one of us. Whatsoever it may be, spiritual wickedness in the high places. So we war not against flesh and blood, but we have so many common enemies. Who has the enemy's government? What our danger is, what we have to put on this whole armor of God, considering what sort of enemies we have to deal with. We should have the armor according to the enemy. What type of enemy? For we wrestle not against flesh and blood. The combat for which we are to be prepared is not against ordinary human enemies. Not barely against men compounded with flesh and blood. Nor against our own corrupt nature singly considered, but against several ranks of devils. We have to fight with several ranks of devils who have a government which they exercise this world. They have a government, they exercise their government in this world. We have to do with a subtle enemy, an enemy who uses wiles and stratagem. He works in an organized way. We should know. That's what God says, submit yourselves to the Lord and resist the devil, and the devil will flee from you. Or do we flee from the devil? What does the Bible say? Submit yourselves to the Lord and resist the devil, and the devil will flee from you. We will never flee from the devil. That's what the Bible says. Devil will flee from you. He's a powerful enemy, principalities, powers, and rulers. They are numerous. They are vigorous, the enemy, and rule in those heathen nations which are yet in darkness. The dark part of the world are the seat of Satan's empire. They are spiritual enemies, spiritual wickedness in high places. The devil is a wicked spirit, and our danger is greater from our enemies because they are unseen. We cannot see them, and they can attack us from darkness. They can assault us. They chiefly annoy the saints and provoke them in spiritual wickedness, pride, envy, etc. These enemies are said to be in high places or in heavenly places. We wrestle about heavenly places or heavenly things. Our enemies strive to prevent our ascent to heaven. Even if you read the book of Revelation, because Zechariah says when Jesus is going to come on the Mount Olives, this enemy is going to stop Jesus coming. That's what we were studying in that class. And our ascension, our rapture, he's trying to stop. He has all kinds of stratagems. He has all kinds of programs. He's organized. He brings a lot of confusions and difficulties. So we should be aware of this enemy. See, the authority of a believer is not selected person's property. Something only a pastor can use that authority. Some people think preachers like Benny Hinn has only got the authority. Sorry for taking somebody's name. Some people think only a particular person has only authority. The word of God says in the book of Mark chapter 16 to 18. The scripture says, he that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. He that believeth and baptized shall be saved, but he that believeth not shall be damned. Verse 17 says, and these signs shall follow them that believeth. Hello? These signs shall follow them. The pastor? No. The evangelist? No. The great preacher? The deacon? No. Or the priest? These signs shall follow them that believe us. In my name, they shall cast out demons. Hallelujah. In my name, they shall speak in new tongues. In my name, they shall take out serpents. And in my name, hallelujah, they shall take any deadly things and shall not harm them. In my name, they shall lay hand on the sick, and the sick shall be recovered. Can you say amen? I want some hallelujah, amen in between. Amen. I want some noise in between. Hallelujah. In my name, they shall hand on the sick. There's a scripture in the Bible, be still and know that I am God. But not this time. Just listen. Hallelujah. Praise God. So what of God says, in my name, you shall do these things. Who shall do? He that believeth. The believers shall do the miracles and wonders. The believers shall speak in new tongues. The believers shall lay hand on the sick and shall be recovered. It is for every believer. Hallelujah. Bible does not say these signs shall follow a particular person. I want you to read one more scripture. Ephesians chapter 1 verse 3. Book of Ephesians chapter 1 verse 3. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with all spiritual blessings. Can you say all spiritual blessings? All spiritual blessings. Blessed be the God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places. Blessed each one of us with all the blessings. It's not only a particular blessing. Here Paul talking about the whole church and not about a few selected believers or individuals. In Christ Jesus, all spiritual blessings belongs to us. The Bible says, this is our promise. However, if you do not use this promise, it won't be any good. On this occasion, on this context, I want to say a story, a history. It's not a story, his story. A thing happened 75 years ago, almost. There lived a beggar. A poor man in Chicago. You know where Chicago, everyone knows. Chicago in America. President Obama's place. So easy to. So he was very poor. He didn't have enough money. He rented a room for $3 per day. No, per week. You know how nice room it will be. But it was 75 years ago. And he was dressed in rags, torn clothes, dirty clothes. He lived in the room. Every day he walked outside asking alms, begging. And after that he goes to the garbage can, pick up the trash and eat the food, what is left out there. 20 long years this poor man did the same thing. I was calculating the price of that, the $3 per day. Today's valuation from that day, it was $50 per week. That means $200 we can get a small apartment. 20 long years, he was going and picking up the trash and asking alms. All of a sudden, he disappeared. The neighbors thought, what happened to this man? Where did he go? When they knocked at his door, no answer. The door was locked from inside. They informed the police. The police came and did the same. He didn't open. They broke open the door. found the poor man dead. They took his dead body for the inspection, for what happened. They want to find out what was wrong with him. While they were checking his body, they found that man, with a wallet on his side. They checked the wallet. There was $2,300 piled in his wallet. How much? $2,300. You know what's the value of that money today? I was checking the 75 years ago value and today comparison. $368,000. Oh my. Ready currency in his wallet. How many of you carry that much money? He would have done a lot of things instead of going and picking up the garbage and eating. Hello? He didn't understand the value of the money. And in those days, I have a list of the things what we can buy with those value of the money. If you think, a car cost $675 that those days. We could buy a car for $670. He has only $300. Can he buy a car easily? He would have bought. Gasoline cost only 20 cents a gallon those days. Man, you'd have drowned in the gasoline with that money. He could buy a house in those days, only $6,600 for a house. Now it is $600,000. Had he got enough money to buy a house then? Why should he rent for $3 per week? Then he could buy a loaf of bread for 9 cents. He would have brought enough bread than picking up the garbage and eating. He could buy a gallon of milk for 50 cents, half dollar. A postage stamp cost only 3 cents. He would have sent airline mails instead of second class mail. The average annual salary was $1,700. People make a week now. Why I'm quoting these things? Because he had $2,300 ready cash with him, and he never knew the value of that money. He would have lived a royal life. He would have, hallelujah, lived in Hyatt Regency Hotel than staying in a $3 apartment. He would have ate nice in a nice restaurant. He would have bought a nice suit. Not like me. Maybe Pastor Matt. Nice suit. He would have drove a Rolls Royce or a Cadillac. But poor man never knew the value of that money, even though he was carrying. You know why I said this story now? Hello? You know why? You and I, we are like that. We have 1,522 promises in the Bible. Hello, I'm going to repeat. We have 1,522 promises in the Bible. We have 1,522 promises in the Bible. How many? Don't forget, 1,522 promises in the Bible. When the promise is there, the word of God says, the promise is for you and for your children. Hallelujah, why should we go and beg? Please pray for me. I have cancer. The word of God says, the promise is for you and for your children. That's what Apostle Peter prayed on the day of Pentecost. Hallelujah. Amen. Can you say hallelujah? Hallelujah? Let the voice come louder. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He can do great miracles. When the word of God says, Isaiah chapter 53 verse 5, what does it say? Isaiah 53:5 says, But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. And with his stripes, you are healed. Or we are healed. Who wrote the scripture? Who wrote the scripture? Isaiah. When did he write the scripture? Before, 700 years before the birth of Jesus. And he didn't know what he writes, about whom he wrote. He says, by his stripes, hallelujah, by his stripes, we are healed. That is in present continuous tense. We are healed. Apostle Matthew, the disciple, died. Book of Matthew, chapter 8, verse 17. That it might be fulfilled which was spoken by Isaiah the prophet, saying, himself took our infirmities and bare our sickness. Matthew quote the scripture. Matthew chapter 8, verse 17. Psalm 103, 1 to 3. Bless the Lord, O my soul. All that is within me, bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul. Forget not all his benefits. Who forgiveth all thine iniquities. Not only one. He who forgiveth all thine iniquities. Who healeth all thy diseases. Hallelujah. Can you say all? All your disease. Your headache, your cancer, your diabetes, your triglyceride. He is forgiveth and healeth all your diseases. Hallelujah. Praise Jesus. Jesus said, the heaven and the earth shall pass away. My way shall never pass away. Jeremy, book of Jeremiah says, I am watching over the ways to come into pass. The promises. Then God has said it will come into pass. Come into pass. The heaven and the earth shall pass away. But my ways never shall pass away. See, if you read book of John chapter 1, in the beginning was the word was with God, the word was God. And the word became flesh and dwelt among us. We have that word, that Jesus, written and given to us. And the heaven and the earth shall pass away. That word shall never pass away. Who forgiveth all thine iniquities. And healeth all thine diseases. If you read 1 Peter 2:24, it says, who his own self bare our sins in his own body on the tree, that we being dead to sins should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes ye were healed. Who writes this one? Peter. Who is Peter? Old Testament or New Testament? New Testament. Who is Peter? One among the 12 apostles. He was in the inner circle, Peter, John, and James. And Peter says, by whose stripes? Look at the tense. Ye were healed. It is in past tense. I say right in present tense. You are healed and you were healed. That means you and I do not need any more healing now. It's already taken place when Jesus said it is finished. Amen. Hallelujah. Done it. It is done. Amen. We have been healed at the cross of Calvary 2,000 years ago. That's what the scripture says. If you look at the scripture, Philippians 4:19 says, when we struggle with the financial problems, we all face that problems. Philippians 4:19 says, my God shall supply all your needs. Can you say all your needs? Hallelujah, not part of your needs. entire your needs. My God shall supply all your needs according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. And the God, word of God says that you were healed 2,000 years ago. I want to conclude my words. How many of you know my wife here? Honey, please stand. I'm not going to call you here and embarrass you, but stand there. You all have seen her. Does she look sick and weak? 27 years ago, 1985, July 3rd, it's already passed. Doctor, one surgeon told me she will not live for one more week. It was in a critical condition, 1985. She had severe stomach pain. I took her to one doctor, second doctor, third doctor. They all gave her all kinds of medicines, what they learned. They wrote everything, all kind of capsules and antibiotics and tablets and shots every day. One nurse used to come and give her shots every day for 6 months continuously. It became worse, nothing better. I'm giving a living testimony. I'm not borrowing anybody's testimony, only I'm borrowing my wife's testimony. She used to work as the principal of the Christian high school where we started. In spite of all the sickness, she never gave up her ministry responsibilities. One day, I was so caught up in the ministry, morning till evening, church. I was a senior pastor as well as the head of the mission work and high school, and so many works we had there. For 25 years, we did the same ministry. One day I noticed she was walking and she could not walk. Stumbling, she's going to fall. Her health deteriorated. Or just she's very skinny, skin and bone. That shocked my life. I took her immediately to the doctor and asked, "Doctor, you have been treating her for 6 months with all the medications and all the poisons you are injecting in her body. Tell me frankly, what's wrong with her? How come she's not getting better?" He diagnosed and said she has a uterus tumor. It is in the last stage. It might burst within 1 week. I asked him, "Why don't you do a surgery and take it out, the uterus?" He said, "I can do it. I am a surgeon. I do surgery for many people, but I'm not going to do for her because I think you are my family. I don't want to do any surgery on my family." So he gave me a referral letter for the top doctor. Said within 1 week, it will be dangerous. If that burst in her uterus, no way she can be survived. We came home. I didn't tell anyone. I didn't tell my wife. We tell this thing, kind of things to the patients, what will happen? Job says, "What I have feared came upon me." Job feared that came upon him. All the destruction, the fear that eat you up. I know one of the richest men in that town, that city. They have cinema, movie theater and so many things, hotels they're running. He had some sickness, went to the doctor. Doctor said, you have this problem. I cannot do it. Go to capital, get treated. On the way he died because he got feared. I knew that story. I didn't tell her. Only the doctor, my God, and me. I didn't tell anyone. I came home and I said, "Honey, let's go to this place and throw the doctor." Morning, we were ready, and she started shivering and said, "No, I cannot do. I cannot do. I cannot get ready now." We missed that day. Second day, said, "Okay, we'll go next day." She couldn't get ready. Then I gave the hope. I asked my wife, honey, where are the medications? She said, they are on the shelf. I took all the medications in my hand, and I came out of my room, and I held the medication in my hand and said, medicine, I curse you in Jesus' name. I spat over the medicine and threw it on the floor, stamped over the medication and said, medicine, I curse you in Jesus' name. Devil, I'm not going to give any more medication to my wife from today onwards. When the word of God says, 1 Peter 2:27, she was healed 2,000 years ago. She does not need any more healing. She already got healed. Then I went in the room. I wrote some of the scriptures which I read, healing scriptures. And I gave my wife and said, honey, you read the scripture. This is your medication from today onwards. Believe in God. Morning, afternoon and evening. 3 times a day she was reading. I have seen her when the pain medication all stopped, when uterus problem, pain, tumor. She was just struggling and said, devil, I tell you in Jesus' name, I was healed. I don't need any more healing now. She was struggling and saying, she held on to that scripture. She was confessing. Hallelujah. Then I did not tell, my own brother was there working in our ministry. Now he lives in Harrisburg, Pennsylvania. I didn't tell him even that problem. I didn't tell anyone. The book of Nehemiah says, Nehemiah said, I didn't tell when he was making the wall. He didn't tell only my donkey, my God, and he knew. I knew that scripture. No one else knew. I don't want the devil to hear. See, when you speak, the devil will hear. Devil does not know how to read the Bible. You understand? He does not know how to read, but he hear and don't speak out many things before the devil. Then I told my associates, some of the teachers who worked, the ministers who worked, we are going to have a fasting prayer. I declare a fast for 1 week. We are working up to evening, 8 evening till midnight. I read the scripture and explained about the healing. And we worship the Lord. We didn't sit silently. We were shouting and worshiping. I heard this, all the instruments, the accordion and everything. We played at midnight, disturbing all the neighbors and worshiping. Hallelujah. She used to confess the scripture every day, 3 times a day. She didn't touch any medication. Exactly after 1 week, a miracle happened. The uterus tumor came externally. And she wondered what happened. Something is developing like a boil. I said, God is doing a miracle. Praise God. It burst. The pus came out. And she had a sinus from her uterus for a whole year. 1 year she suffered. 1986, me and my brother, we went to Amsterdam for Dr. Billy Graham's program in Amsterdam, Holland. Then I sent my wife and my daughter, she was 6 or 7 years old, sent them to South India, to her parents and my parents. When she went there, her parents, man, what's wrong with her? Look at her health. And they were so worried. But they were Pentecostal believers, they prayed. But her elder brother, he was an officer in Qatar, Arab countries. He was the deputy director of the whole country for the Qatar insurance. He's a church-going person, not a Pentecostal. He dragged her. How come you are like this when you have this problem? Dragged her to the medical college and the medical university and took her to some gynecologist. They examined her and said, this is such a complicated case we never seen. So we can do surgery, but she has to take a medication and the sinus should be closed. So you need to take some medication. They prescribed some medicine and said, if you take this medication, she will have side effects, throwing up and all kind of problems. If you can get medication, good medicine from America, she will not throw up. There are no side effects. So her own sister, she used to be a nurse in Toronto, Canada, immediately telephoned her. She bought the medication, sent it by next day mail. And my wife says, whenever she took the medication in her hand, The Spirit of God says, don't touch the medication. Hallelujah. Her parents and brother asked, do you take the medicine? She lied and said, I took. She never opened a seal. When she didn't touch the medication, hallelujah, that sinus closed automatically. Can you say hallelujah? Praise you, Jesus. I am not against medication. We take medication. I am not preaching against medication. If you have faith. Then. So God, the word of God says, by his stripes you were healed. I want to conclude my words. I think my time is up.